2 years ago, four museums were set to present a retrospective of painter Philip Guston. And then, in one of the biggest controversies to hit the art world in the last few years, it all imploded. Now, the show has finally launched at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. Special correspondent Jared Bowen of GBH Boston has the story for our Arts and Culture series, Canvas, and a warning, some of the artwork may be disturbing to viewers.
Philip Guston was the Jewish son of immigrant parents from present-day Ukraine, who learned early on what it meant to be a Jew in America.
The seminal moment for him is in 1933 in LA, when he submits a work showing Klan violence to an exhibition, and it's vandalized by the Red Squad of the LAPD, which has affiliations with the Klan.
The event marked him deeply enough that within 4 years, the then Philip Goldstein changed his name to Guston, and he embarked on a career that, alongside his high school friend Jackson Pollock, would make him one of the most famous names in 20th century art.
Guston is, in the 40s, 50s, one of the great abstract expressionist painters, selling out shows, but always feels the limits of that approach to painting.
Ethan Lasser is co-curator of the nationally touring exhibition Philip Guston Now, which recently opened at the Museum of Fine Arts Boston. It's a retrospective that charts how hate and anti-Semitism churned within Guston.
In 1968, as he's watching TV, he's watching Kent State, he's watching Vietnam, and he says, what kind of man am I going into my studio to adjust a red to a blue to make abstract paintings? What can an abstract painting actually say in the world of civil rights?
So the painter made a pivot, walking away from abstract expressionism. It was abrupt and, to the art world, unforgivable. Taking cues from the Sunday comics and Crazy Cat in particular, he started painting cartoonish images, often in pink, a comics color, but one that can also be read as fleshy and raw. And in a motif that would appear throughout most of his 50-year career, he painted the Ku Klux Klan. Guston did not discuss his work. That's been left to interpreters like Lasser.
What he paints are images of Klansmen who had haunted Guston since he was a young artist, images of himself in a hood as a Klansman painting, images that call to account the underlying, I think, structures of racism in the art world and in America in general.
How do you create a way for those images to be understood?
Matthew Teitelbaum is the MFA's director. He, along with the heads of three other presenting museums, were caught in a firestorm of controversy in 2020 when the show was set to open at the National Gallery in Washington, D.C.
We're marching for black life.
In the wake of George Floyd's murder and ensuing protests, the museums, which also included MFA Houston and London's Tate Modern, chose to postpone the show 4 years when they announced the work, including its KKK imagery, could be, quote, more clearly interpreted.
We felt it was a very charged moment to talk about race and to not have the community voices helping us interpret how these images would be received. It was never about whether or not Guston had a voice that we needed to hear at any time and at all times.
But that's not how the art world saw it. Thousands of artists, curators, and writers signed a petition blasting the museum's decision and accused them of, quote, lacking faith in the intelligence of their audience, and worse.
How much did it hit you when you were accused by artists, you being the four institutions, of cowardice?
I've never had anybody say that about me before, and it wasn't something that I even thought about. It wasn't about avoiding something.
Instead, the MFA is now launching the national tour 2 years ahead of schedule. It's curated the show unlike any other, inviting museum staff to weigh in, engaging a trauma specialist, and expanding the curatorial team to four, including guest curator Terrence Washington.
The debate around the controversy talked about this exhibition as being the one that would start a conversation about whiteness, and it would hold up a mirror to people who would storm the Capitol, .. And I just thought, yeah, but like, are those people coming in? This feels really abstract.
Washington's approach had less to do with Guston than museums themselves. Are they, he wonders, as accessible as they claim?
To me, that's the central thing. How do we understand why exhibitions are done and for whom they're done? All these places are open because they're supposed to be for everybody. And I'm just not sure that that's the case.
Each of the four museums is devising their own plan for showing the work. Here at the MFA, some of Guston's most searing hood paintings are on view in a single gallery. If visitors prefer to avoid them, they're invited to circumvent the space. If they do enter, it's deliberately claustrophobic.
We hope that will cause people to be a little less comfortable. It'll cause people to aestheticize them and neuter the paintings a bit less.
Because Washington wants to ensure that we never get so used to seeing Klan images that we don't really see them anymore. Just as he doesn't want museums to get used to programming with the same old limited perspective.
Whiteness is not abstract. Whiteness is structuring the conversation around this exhibition. It's not something that we can put on and take off.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jared Bowen.